2007, I was working in the Mekong region, which is this river basin. What you're looking at is a map that maps out all the large river basins that originate from the Tibetan Plateau. This is seven biggest rivers in Asia. So on the furthest end, you see Indus, Ganges, Brahmaputra, Salween, Irrawaddy, Mekong, and the Yangtze. And these are all the river basins that come from the Tibetan Plateau. I just moved from working in the Himalayan program for WWF to managing their US portfolio in the Mekong. And in the Himalayas, I worked on community-based conservation. If you guys have any questions about, like, especially labels, just raise your hand and I can answer it. And I felt, although the work I was doing was really satisfying, I could see changes happening at the community level. At the end of the day, it wasn't actually changing anything in terms of conservation targets that we were looking at. But, you know, I was working on tiger conservation especially, and rhino and elephant conservation. And so to work on the Mekong was really something I thought could solve the larger problem, because we were taking a river basin approach that looked at five countries and was developing solutions at a transnational level. And of course, you won't be surprised to find that by the time 2007 came along, I was thoroughly depressed. It felt like that wasn't going to change very much either. But at the end of the day, the barriers to success were so great, starting with, you know, governments not wanting to get involved, massive corruption governance issues, just the fact that, you know, dams make so much money for countries that at the end of the day, whether it actually is hard, it has terrible impact on local communities, wasn't going to change governments' minds. So I'd reached this state that I now have learned is called solastalgia. And if those of you are the ones who work on conservation, it's a word you need to know. Because basically it means depression because you're an environmentalist. And it really talks about I can take a second and explain it, because I think it really matters to young environmentalists to understand what happens in your career as you move along, and especially as you start to do field work. Because you are in the process of rewounding yourself again and again. The successes are so far in between that you just reach this level of, I think, hopelessness. And that's very much where I was in 2007. So I come from Sikkim in the Himalayas, and I come from a very religious Buddhist family. And like every year, I would get a call and said, you need to come home. We're going on annual pilgrimage, and you need to be there. So that year, I went to Bodh Gaya, which is, in some sense, the center of Buddhism. This is where Buddha was enlightened. This is where all Buddhists eventually go on pilgrimage. And I got to hear a talk by His Holiness the 17th Karmapa, who's here, presented. He's the head of my lineage, and I didn't know at that time, but he was actually a rising environmentalist, a burgeoning environmentalist. And he gave a talk on why forestation matters to Buddhism. And, you know, starting with the explanation of how trees are embedded in the entire history of Buddhism, but going on to say that if you actually want to make long life prayers for your teachers, like the Dalai Lama, why not plant a tree? Because a tree actually gives life to all humanity. So why would you not plant a tree in the name of the affection you have for your loved ones or for your teachers? And it was this epiphany for me, because I'd never realized that my world as a Buddhist and my world as a conservationist could come together. As karma has it, I actually had a meeting with His Holiness a little bit later. And in that meeting, I was presenting, so I used to go and do environmental presentations to His Holiness. In that meeting, he actually cut the presentation and said, I've been hearing people talk about environmental problems for years, and what I want to know is, how can monks and nuns actually be part of the solution? How is it, what can I tell the monks and nuns so that they will actually understand the issue better, they understand it in the Buddhist context, and then they end up doing something about it? It's a revolutionary thought. Buddhism is very much about, you know, and I think even in the mainstream, it's presented very much as a religion that is a little detached, because you're meditating on the nature of emptiness for the most part. Compassion is something you do sitting on the meditation mat. And what he was saying is compassion is actually action. You have to get off the meditation mat and go to your community and solve the problems there. So we came up with this idea. You can see the book he's holding, Environmental Guidelines for Tibetan Buddhist Community, Monasteries and Nunneries. It was something that hadn't been done before. It was unprecedented that we were creating guidelines based on Buddhist theology, based on the philosophy, but talking about the science and explaining what monks and nuns can do. I imagine that it was a two-week process. I thought it was a two-week project. You know, I'm such a good Buddhist. And I'm still doing this work 10 years later. So what happened when we presented that book to the monks and nuns after going through it for about 6 months? We published it, we gave it to the monasteries, and they came back saying, this isn't enough, we actually need training, we need to understand the science better. So we held the first conference in 2008, and we ended up going through what any of us would go through if we were working with community people. You know, doing a root cause analysis, problem solving, coming up with targets, coming up with strategies. And the monasteries that sent delegates, so there were 22 monasteries present for this conference in 2008, ended up picking the issues they wanted to work in based on what they were seeing in their community. So even though you would have, you know, three monasteries within a 50-mile radius, some were prioritizing climate change first, some were prioritizing water first, some were saying forest is the biggest issue because we have so many landslides. So the first thing that I think was really different in this approach to working with religions was that unknowingly, I basically gave a conservation strategy model to them, and that's how the organization has developed. So that was in 2008. Since then, we established an entire association. So the organization is called Koyur, which means environment in Tibetan. There are 55 monasteries involved that are all carrying out very tangible projects that are, for the most part, measurable. I have to say, I would break them up into one-thirds. One-thirds is like A, you know, B plus. The middle group is like a B minus C. And then the third group is and the C minus level. But what's been interesting to me is that they actually span the entire Himalayan range, and they are also active in the Tibetan Plateau. So we don't measure what happens in the Tibetan Plateau, of course, but they are present all the way from Ladakh in northwest India to Bhutan. We've had 8 annual training conferences. Each conference has a topic, which the monks and nuns tell us the preceding year, and then we bring the experts to that conference. There have been 14 regional workshops. Every year, the monks and nuns basically make a commitment to plant 25,000 indigenous tree saplings. I have to tell you, it's more like 50,000 that they end up planting. The majority of the monasteries shifted to solar. They are all plastic-free. They all segregate waste. They have monthly cleanups, which is a huge deal. If you're a Himalayan, and you're, especially in the Buddhist community, you're used to seeing the monks up on a throne. And the idea that they would come out and do what is considered really low-caste work, like picking up garbage with their hands, is a very jarring image for a lot of people in the Himalayas. And it's something that forces a conversation in the community about what civic responsibility is. They talk a lot about wildlife, especially. That's been a big part of my, and because I used to work for WWF, obviously I ended up asking for a lot of commitments on wildlife protection. And finally, what's really interesting to me is when it comes to climate change, and they always see it within the wider lens of compassion for the earth. And so all the monasteries are vegetarian, and they always say it's partly because of their ideals of compassion, and partly because of climate change, because they understand the impact it has. So here are some photos. You guys, I'll just zoom through them so you can see what the work actually looks like. One thing that was really interesting to me is that, so this is in Bodha, which is a very famous site in Nepal, in Kathmandu. So when the monasteries and nunneries started adopting solar energy, what they started reporting to us is that the hotel managers and the restaurant managers came to them to say, how did you do it? Where did you get it? Because there's so much load shedding in the Himalayas. Electricity is such a major problem. So they didn't, the second layer of people who are influenced aren't doing it for environmental reasons, but they see it as something that solves a different problem they have. So it created this knock-on effect that we hadn't anticipated as project designers. A lot of the monasteries have switched to organic farming. A lot of the farmers, if you go into the nunneries and monasteries, you'll see that they're actually doing plantations. There's a lot of messaging on wildlife protection. So, you know, all the festivals, there's usually a play that the monks and nuns put out, and there's a very strong wildlife protection theme. This is Bagmati, also in Nepal, where monks and nuns go and do cleanup. It's also a river that's constantly flooding, so they're very involved in restoration work. There's a segregation of plastic. Now, why would we approach monasteries and nunneries in the Himalayas from a conservation perspective? For those of you who don't know the region very well, it's actually a region where their religion is practiced on a very high level. the vast majority of the population, 95%, identify with a religion, and that's part of their personal identity, that they are religious. Many of the communities are in very remote areas, and the monastery is the collection point. That's where they go for problems, that's where they go for events. They're used to seeing them as decision makers. The influence that monasteries have radiated to local communities. I know of, you know, high lamas who influence where roads go, definitely influence who you marry, when you marry, what land you buy, why you buy, where you buy, all of that eventually goes to the high lama, and he will tell you, I think you should do it this way or that way. So in terms of influence, they're enormous. But they are also, interestingly, a stakeholder group that's often ignored by conservation. These are people who are massive consumers. The monasteries can, you know, include 1,000 people that are buying vegetables, buying rice, buying trucks, constructing, building, and so on. And we're oblivious to the fact that they actually, collectively, as a stakeholder group, are quite influential and large. The two issues that I've found in my work with religious leaders that come up almost instantly are climate change and freshwater. If you're in the Himalayas, these are the two issues that people are generally most aware of, and also that people feel most helpless about. And so we ended up in 2011 focusing on climate change and breaking it down, just like we would with any stakeholder group, breaking down what the impact would look like by sector for monasteries and nunneries, and coming up with suggested responses. So if you look at water, for example, you know that monasteries and nunneries create their own rainwater harvesting system instead of being dependent on pipes that are like very easily broken, cracked, that, you know, kind of you run out of water quite fast and so on. Out of this conference came a request that we focus on disaster management. So in 2011, we ended up focusing on the topic of disaster management. So for 7 days, that's all they learned about. As you know, the Himalayas is very disaster prone. There have been 3 massive earthquakes all above a 6.5 Richter scale in the last 6 years. So Sikkim in 2011, Nepal in 2015, and Manipur last year. Thousands of lives have been lost. What was really interesting after the 2015 earthquake was that the monks and nuns that had gone through the disaster management training came back and reported to His Holiness that actually the training they did 2 years ago ended up protecting them. So as I mentioned earlier, many of them switched to solar after this workshop. A lot of them had switched to organic gardening, organic farming. They had stored water, they had stored food, they had a disaster management plan, sort of. They had a manager that was actually in charge if a disaster hit. So some of the things we had taught them very generally about disaster management ended up almost instantly being implemented when the earthquake hit. Monks and nuns were pretty much the first responders in their local communities, and they ended up, because they are set up in a way that they can provide service to a large group of people, they ended up being a lot of the de facto rescue operators. So if you think about it, they're used to large numbers of people. They have kitchens that feed hundreds of people at a time. So they have usually independent water sources. And then they also had a lot of vegetables and so on because of their gardens. So when they came back and told His Holiness that this one workshop ended up having this enormous impact, His Holiness turned around and said, that's the topic I want all of you to focus on. So since then, 2015, 16, and 17, all I've worked on with Koryog is disaster management. So I don't have a hard copy with me, but this is available online, and I can send you the link if you want. So just the beginning of this year, we published disaster management guidelines for Tibetan monasteries and nunneries. Again, it's unprecedented. Nothing like this exists for a religious institution. It has everything, well, so basically, we have 5 topics we focused on: floods, storms, fires, landscapes, earthquakes. These are the 5 topics that are the most common in the Himalayas. Each of the solution section has 3: prepare. So this is the example of storms. Respond. What do you do when that problem happens? And then how do you recover from it? And so recovery is a little bit of a mishmash because we put in some mitigation as well, activities. But for the most part, it's what do you do after the problem and you're trying to now recover. One thing that this book has that I'm really still very grateful and amazed about is there's a chapter on mental trauma that His Holiness wrote. So it's called Healing the Heart and Mind, because this was something that he said he was really affected by, the fact that after the disaster, people were coming to him, monks and nuns, were coming to him saying, you know, I'm depressed and I feel helpless and, you know, I don't know exactly how to get over it because I'm a monk. I've already taken vows, you know, and yet people turn to me for problems and yet I feel I haven't actually gotten over it. So there was a chapter in here for specifically for mental trauma and emotional trauma. And along with the book, we actually started CERT training for monks and nuns. So CERT is Community Emergency Relief Training, I believe. And we now have 200 monks across the Himalayas and, I mean, across Nepal and Tibet. I mean, Nepal and India. And then there are 6 monks and nuns who are trained in CERT in Bhutan. And the idea of doing CERT training is they actually know what to do when an emergency happens. They know, for example, how to build a stretcher. They already have a team in place as first responders. They know how to decide that a building is safe or not. How do you evacuate people? It's very practical. It's very on the ground. So we have 200 of them spread across the region now. We also have about 50 nuns who are focused especially on first aid. So these are nuns who know how to create a splint, how do you detect if there's internal injury and hemorrhaging and so on. I think in terms of saying that Koryuk is a fantastic case study for why you would work with religions on conservation, it's a given. And most people react in a very positive way. When I say I work with religious leaders and they say who, and I start with Buddhists, they're like, oh yeah, but that's the low hanging fruit. This is what I usually get. You know, Buddhist is the most secular, the most scientific religion. You know, it's the least religious of all religions and so on. But the argument that I have been making all along is that it's not just Buddhism. We should actually be working with all religious groups. And that by not working with them, we're actually not tapping into the largest group of allies that we have and the most influential group of people in the world. Because if you actually work it down by numbers, fewer people listen to scientists than religious leaders, I can tell you that. Or NGOs or governments. So over 80% of people follow a faith. Collectively, religious groups own almost 8% of total habitable land. They constitute the third largest category of financial investors. They set up, run, or otherwise are involved in more than half of all schools worldwide. And yet, as a conservation community, they are just not someone we think of when we think about partnerships. Finally, the real reason I think why we should work with religious groups is we're at a point of time where consumerism is so rampant, it's such a natural part of our identity that we don't even know how to unpackage it. And I especially find that when I talk to students and young people, what they are coming to me about and talking to me about is, well, it doesn't end up being about conservation. People say they want my advice, and really the conversation always ends up being, but what is the meaning of life? And what I always end up thinking about is this quote. Because what we are told by, I think, the lives that we live now is that success is this very linear process, and that part of that is making money, and part of that is consuming as much as you can, and being rich and successful is the purpose of life. And of course, we're not happy with that message. We know at some level that this doesn't fit with our personal philosophy. The reason why I think talking to faiths and working with religious leaders matters so much is because that's what they focus on, and they bring that to the forefront. When you work in conservation, you're forced to make a lot of compromises. You don't think you will, but you end up working with the most corrupt governments, with the corporations that are actually the ones that are causing the problem, and you justify that, because that's, you know, that's a means to an end. It's the opposite when you're working with religious leaders. When you're working with religious leaders, you have to bring your morality to the table. Nothing else is going to convince them. If you are not there as a moral human being with values, they don't want to have a conversation with you. And I think for me personally, as someone who suffered from solastalgia, I can tell you that working with faith leaders revived that part of me. It brought me back to why I became an environmentalist in the first place. And it wasn't about money, power, and success, you know? And so that is, in some sense, what I end up presenting to all the conservationists I know, which is that it heals us. Actually, working with faith leaders is a healing process for us as well as a community. So as Alarf mentioned, I worked in 5 places around the world with different religious leaders. I worked with the Catholic Church and the Islamic Council in Kenya, and I worked with the Catholic Church in Brazil. And I worked with evangelicals in the US, which was by far the hardest thing. By far harder than all the other religions. But I think that was partly because there is this very unnatural divide in the US about religion and science. It's still being debated so much, because the rest of the world doesn't have a problem with holding two inconsistencies in the hand. I feel in the US we're very rigid about it, you know. And also because my conservation colleagues really struggled with the idea of us approaching, WWF approaching religious interests in the US. So it wasn't always easy. There's been a lot of success in the last 7-8 years. For the most part, the religious groups I work with on conservation have continued to do it, whether WWF was involved or not. The Sacred Earth program ended in 2014, but the work has continued. But what I've learned in the process is that there are certain conditions for success. And the first is that your faith leader that you work with has to be inspiring and powerful. They also have to make sure that the people who are the technical people in the institution, the guys who decide how much groceries need to be bought that week, that's the group of people you need to involve and need to work with. That you have to design goals with them. You cannot design the goal here and then take it to them and say that's your goal. That you have to come up with faith-based moral norms and regulations so that it's not coming to them from a secular scientific point of view, it's coming to them as part of their religious ethos. The calls to action have to be very specific. You can go there and talk about climate change in general, but if you don't have a specific action that they can take, it's going to actually end up disempowering them, making them feel really isolated and helpless. The solutions that always had that were always provided a solution for a different problem were the ones that got picked up first and that everybody adopted, like solar and rainwater roof harvesting and so on. I think I said that already. And finally, that people feel proud. So the thing I enjoy the most is that at some point there is this spark in the religious community and they start feeling really proud for being an environmentalist. Like, you know, when the Pope put out the Laudato Si, Catholics felt really proud, and suddenly it's a positive marker for your community. It's a way of, you know, it's a way of recognizing your tribal mate and looking across and saying, this is what we have in common. And we, I think, as people who really ultimately want behavior change, need to understand the psychology of that and adopt that in projects. So that's my presentation. I think the last thing I'm going to say on faith-based conservation is that I was presenting in Colombia just a few months ago. We had the ICCB, the Conservation Biology, Society of Conservation Biology conference. And I talked about this, and somebody started waving their hand pretty much halfway through my presentation, really had a question. And I asked them what their question was, and they said, well, they had a problem with the term faith-based conservation, because it sounds like it's the opposite of evidence-based conservation. It never even occurred to me that somebody could take that away from this term, which I didn't adopt, I didn't create. So I ended up telling them, well, the reason why I use that term is because that's what the health community uses. The health community has been working with faith leaders for over 2 decades, 3 decades, and they have been working on AIDS education, HIV, you know, disasters, water, clean water, so on, and they work on faith-based initiatives. And he said, I don't see why that's relevant. We're not the health community. And all I could think of was, wow, this is conservation. This is conservation's biggest problem in a nutshell. We think it doesn't matter that there are hundreds of billions of dollars that have gone into an industry, that they actually work on issues that impact our issue that we care about. We just don't see that that is equally relevant. When people ask me if I have hope when it comes to environmental issues, I always say yes, because what I notice is young people are talking about intersectionality. And to me, that is so brilliant, because when I was in school, which is now like 25 years ago, that was not an issue we could talk about. Nobody was allowed to really leave the field and go study other fields at the same time. It was you had to master your field. There is a poster out there right outside Women's that says, like, the topic of intersectionality. It's on the 10th. You guys should go. I think that is the key. Instead of sticking to our barriers and sticking within our boundaries, we have to understand that the best work in any field that happens in the boundary areas. It happens in those really awkward areas where you're actually bridging gaps and reaching out to different areas. So I'm going to leave you with that. Go out and work in boundary areas.